Mr. Narendra Modi took over as the Prime Minister of India, 11 days short of 50 years after the passing away of late Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru on 27th May 1964. So it has a certain symbolic meaning. Before I say, go into the question that you have posed, let me say that, as is correct for prime ministers, he had a presentation and an interaction with one of India's most reputed authors, thinkers, strategic thinker, and that interaction, if it is on record, would have been nearly 2 hours, in which this professor, based in Delhi, gave him a complete, comprehensive, all-round picture of global, regional, and India national security issues, challenges, opportunities, vis-a-vis our resource base, and what ought to be done, or what he recommended to the incoming Prime Minister, that is military strategy planning, modernization of the armed forces, restructuring of the armed forces with reference also to the state of morale and the state of combat readiness, which is related to morale and well-being of the soldier, sailor in Yemen. And this was a briefing which, in my view, I've heard some excerpts of it, was a briefing and interaction presentation which should have given the incoming Prime Minister, or rather the Prime Minister of India, a very good picture of what is, what are the problems, what are the challenges, and what he might consider in due course. It was not really concentrated in the area of nuclear matters or nuclear posture, but away from that. Now, as you know, a new team took over, which was his choice, advisors and aides, and they began functioning in a very different way than what might have been suggested to him by the person I referred to. That is because they had their own agenda, they had their own understanding of, or rather, their own worldview, which, in my view, of course, was not related to reality, but to dreams, to aspirations. And they also had a mission of making India a great power with a nationalist focus. Now, it's very simple. They took a path, but nationalism, but rather sovereignty of the nation, or sovereignty of India, is actually what gives us the focus on nationalism. You cannot have nationalism unless you look at how sovereign India was at that moment, how all your decision, all your planning, all your program, all that you did here and after would actually erode sovereignty, not restore it, not strengthen it. Nevertheless, we arrived into 2014. Your question might suggest as if there was a new beginning, a departure from the old policy of the last 20 years minimum, 22 years, and something new was on the anvil, but it was not so. It was not a sudden departure from what had been built up from what I call 1991, which is the kind of political and economic surrender forced on this country and accepted by the then government of conditionalities of the World Bank and IMF, which is a very well-known process of surrender of sovereignty with respect to decision-making, independent path of development or autonomous path of development. But strangely, coincidentally, this was also happening so far as Russia, the Soviet Union and its successor state Russia, which happened in a kind of a stealth coup against the then Soviet Union. Most people call it collapse. It was not a collapse at all. It was a political surrender by the people, by Gorbachev and by Yeltsin. A similar process, it might surprise you, was also taking place in China. But I said a similar process. The Chicago School and its ideas on how to run a political economy were predominant, according to some authors and some reports, in Beijing also. But China, it must be said to their credit, restored its sovereignty, and I would say that it's one of the few fully sovereign nations, though it has got intimate relations with the capitalist world. A similar process took place after 10 years in successor state Russia, and President Putin in particular must be given the credit for restoring the sovereignty of Russia and the Russian people. He has gone on record both at Munich in 2007 and now to say that most of the countries of the world, or many of the countries of the world, have lost their sovereignty in one degree or the other. And not Russia. No. Russia, in fact, is the foremost sovereign state so far as the world is concerned. So there's a background. And this background, the most happening thing happened. Most happening thing happened in 2005. There were many other steps, of course, preceding that. Agreement on agriculture, reduction of tariffs or lowering of tariffs. That was separate. But I would say that the matrix of the 2005 Indo-US Defense Framework Agreement was really the turning point so far as defense, maritime policy and all other matters related to national security are concerned. Because in this one document, which the then Defense Minister, Shri Pranab Mukherjee, signed in Washington, D.C., is everything, because it's a matrix. That is, from within, it has very large implications, substantive implications on all that followed and is continuing. So what happened? When asked, the Defense Minister, Mr. Mukherjee, told Parliament and his friends in Parliament, members of Parliament, that I am simply going for talks and discussions as has been routine between any two countries, particularly the then lone superpower of the world. And it's taken for granted, but he came back with a matrix, as I said, with the framework, defense framework agreement, which had a tremendous effect on the policies as they existed not only in the Nehru era, but Indira Gandhi era, Rajiv Gandhi era, and so on. So what was that? What was it? Well, either we did not read the text and subtext and subclauses of the Defense Framework Agreement, or that the meaning that was on paper in the document, the plain reading of the document, had inbuilt into it the matrix, as I said, which led to then a free-for-all. It meant the opening of all doors as far as the South Bloc and North Bloc was concerned. Even though there is a historical process, they're the institutional memory of the Ministry of External Affairs, and there must have been at least a few good people who tried to remind the government of the day what this comprised of, what was our track record, what was our experience, what was our experience of bilateral relations with other nations, particularly the United States being the most powerful then nation. So there it was. In the interim, while Limoa talk about bases in India, facilitating bases, servicing bases, technical bases for technical stops of flights and maintenance, etc., were going on, Limoa, Bika, Sismoa, and they have graduated in Malabar exercises, becoming larger, bigger, having more participation. Talk of interoperability between the US fleet and the Indian Navy in particular. What was it leading to? If you recall, Iran was the hot spot. Everything was centered around some invasion, some attack, some denuclearization of Iran. So the old concept, thanks to the people in the media, and thanks to the spin doctors, and thanks to the think tanks in Delhi, Carnegie and Brookings, are new phenomena. They started playing around with these words and suggesting it is only thanks to the much criticized Defense Minister Antony, aka Antony, that he realizing the things were sliding too fast on a very slippery slope, that he tried to slow down that process. So he deserves some credit for that, even though names are not important. Names are not very important. Because UPA 2 and UPA 1 were in fact complicit in the whole program. They thought that the world has changed. They thought that the United States is a lone superpower. They bought the whole idea of Project for the New American Century. The hegemony of US worldwide interest. They, for them, nothing happened. Neither 2001 attack and invasion or occupation of Afghanistan, though it is only 300-400 kilometers from Delhi, nothing happened. We all, in fact, offered them bases, air bases. The three chiefs made a statement that they will offer Pathankot, Avantipur, and one more air station for the American armed forces to operate against Afghanistan. But thank God that this Americans chose Pakistan rather than India as the logistic support post. So there's a whole history, and that's why I'm mentioning it. Right? So, and then we come to this 2005, then we come to the 2008 Indo-US civil nuclear agreement, and then we come to all this Malabar exercises. We start talking about America, US, because US buzzword, everything that emanates from Washington DC, with a particular reference to the Pentagon, became buzzwords. And we had a new term gifted to the Indian Navy, shall I say, through the government, through the NDA, called net security provider. From whence did the Indian Navy become a net security provider? Because it has still got, even though it has made progress and good progress in design and production of ships, we haven't got enough. We haven't got the speed. We haven't got the financial resources, technical resources, design resources to become a net security provider in this whole Indian Ocean region. And then followed several other suggestions. For example, Asia-Pacific to Indo-Pacific. Right? Why? Because we have Indian Ocean, which is named after us. So what do you want to more? What do you want to play around with the Pacific now for? Certainly not as a partner for the ultimate containment of China. I'll come back to that. Then South China Sea. We started raising objections, not on behalf of any country, but on behalf of ourselves on certain suggestions from the same quarters about the South China Sea. While in the meantime, Asia, ASEAN and Southeast Asia diplomacy with China has been so good and so progressive that almost all countries have got bilateral agreements now with China, including Vietnam, saying, and I quote, under new deep conditions with China, new deepening of relations with China. That is the Vietnamese-China communique of last year. So, as I said, expeditionary forces, this is a colonial imperialist term, and against Iran, which is our neighbor, which had energy, it's the real energy reserve for India, the Iran-Pakistan-India pipeline, gas pipeline was scuttled. Under direct pressure, under direct threats from the US Congress and the US Senate, similar to what is now being bandied around about oil imports from Iran. Iran is our old neighbor. In fact, the Indo-Persian period in Indian history stands for all the beautiful, all the amazing cooperation and relations that have existed for thousands of years between Persia, Iran, and India, whether it's architecture, whether it's the language itself of the government and the people. So why are we now, why is it now that we are suggesting that Malabar translates into an expeditionary force in waiting, in being, this is not the naval terminology, expeditionary force joined US, India, UK, Australia, vis-a-vis Iran. It's inexplicable because the entire geopolitical changes, the geo-economic changes, the financial changes, which peaked in 2008 with the crisis and its aftermath, the rise of Russia militarily as well as technologically as well as industrially, and the, if I may say, the very rapid rise of China, particularly after 2010-2012, when it, on the one hand China was an embrace with the United States as far as financial and trade and commercial matters, which are now under strain, and on the other hand it was rising. And when you say rising, it means China becomes a power to reckon with. And most of all, it is Washington DC that realizes the strengths of China. In our country, the new team of advisors, and of course the new government, seem either to know and turn a blind eye to it, or not to know. You can choose any of those options. But the fact is that all this is in the open. All the figures are in the open. All the indices are in the open. How does New Delhi's vast establishment just ignore that the world is changing? Not only changing, I'm talking about the period around 2007 to 2014, like the preceding period of the Modi government, Modi administration, because it's all out. Other than the West are realizing it, they're appreciating it, they're constantly shifting around, and we see tectonic changes. I use the word tectonic changes, the movement of tectonic plates, if you like to call it globally. And this is ignored. Ignored why? The question is why? Why? Some people have suggested, well, it's because Delhi establishment and the ruling establishment, if you like to call it, whether it is UPA 1, 2, earlier, now, have had a pro-West and it's particularly pro-US bias and a prejudice against Asia, in spite of the talk of Asian unity, in spite of the historical experience, in spite of India's struggle for freedom, which embodied that the basic needs of the people and the basic interests of India will reign supreme so far as foreign policy is concerned. And foreign policy is really a coin which is two sides of the same coin. foreign policy, military stroke, maritime policy. Maritime policy does not exist in a vacuum. It is the other side of the coin of foreign policy. And foreign policy itself should be and must be and was based on the strengths and weaknesses of the Indian economy, political economy, as well as the aspirations to be developed so that we can look after the basic needs of 1300 million people. It is not Australia, it is not Austria, it is not Saudi Arabia. India is India. India is a totally different nation. It's a totally different people. It's got totally different requirement. Nobody can, India cannot catch the little finger of a giant or a superpower, because that little finger will cut off by sheer weight, sheer magnitude. So, it's a very strange situation. Others have suggested that the non-resident Indians, about which you have read so many, they'll be given voting rights, they come every year here, they, people go and speak, our leaders go and speak to them in special medicine square and so on and so forth. Are they influencing policy? Are they influencing our maritime policy, military policy, strategic policy, foreign policy? Have they become too? Do they exercise too much leverage now, not only now, even before, but much more particularly now? That's a question mark. I will not answer it. It is for our viewers to take a view on that. But the NRI factor is a factor. The fact is that, as I said, to sum up what I said in the minutes before, it shows, the whole position now shows a complete ignorance of history, a complete ignorance, or shall I say disregard, for colonial and imperial history in Asia, in Africa, everywhere, Latin America, what they did, what they experienced, how much they looted our resources, how Britain became an industrial power because of India, all that is history, and so did China. So was China oppressed and looted, and sometimes with people from India being in the army, in Shanghai and so on, so that is history. So it's a very strange phenomenon. On the one hand, the establishment, which has got so many resources, media resources, intelligence agency resources, foreign service resources, is going around blindly, according to me, and really not only blindly, but into a blind alley, is gone into a cul-de-sac, because where we have landed up is a dangerous abyss because of the sheer number of people involved here whose freedom, whose progress, whose basic needs are involved. So maritime policy started turning and twisting in a very strange way, and I think you referred to bases. Now, I again quote Jawaharlal Nehru in his famous statement on India, how India should develop its maritime strength. He said, India, a peninsular country, lies in the very lap of the oceans. And this plaque and this thing is also engraved at the entrance of the National Defense College in New Delhi. It is known to every foreign service officer because that's a part of his training. It should be known to the administrative services, to the military services, but in their cradles, whether at Khadakwasla, whether at Masuri, or whether at Hyderabad, all these things are a part of their syllabi, training syllabi. And they must be versed in what are they going to defend, what are they going to protect, what are they going to administer, what is it that they are going to do so far as international relations are concerned, but seems to be lost, or at least people chose not to bring it to the notice of, it is their duty to bring it to the notice of the Prime Minister himself and the Cabinet, because in particular in the military, chiefs are not supposed to be yes sir, yes minister types. They have a position as per the Parliamentary Acts, Navy, Army, Air Force Acts and Regulations. So they are not supposed to wag the tails. They are supposed to tell what is possible, what is not possible, what is expedient, what is temporary, what is transient. We make a difference between substantive and transient. But to whole hog parrot this whole line, with the buzzwords come from Washington, as I said, and to go around talking about what I said they are talking about, to actually physically support the idea of the containment of China, which is not possible. And the Americans know it. It was also a policy which was used against the Soviet Union, crafted by George Kennan, the US ambassador to Moscow for 20 years. But he was a knowledgeable person. So this containment of China is really the bandwagon, the Indo-Pacific thing after, it's visible to all that Obama, President Obama's pivot to Asia is in tatters, it's in shambles. The TPP is, the US has withdrawn from the TPP. So how is it that India, which itself, its foremost task is to strengthen the country, militarily, civil development wise, is subscribing, maybe modified in the last few months, to pivot to Asia. Before that, the US security architecture for Asia. After that, what you said, it is not possible. It is not possible to understand. Because you are, God has given you, destiny has given you, India a unique position. It is a peninsular country. It has Andaman and Nicobar Islands, which actually the British imperial policy was to not transfer them to India in 1947. Indira Point, which is Nicobar, is 90 miles from the western entrance of Malacca Straits. 90 miles, it's there. It is standing there, geographically standing there. So, and you've got Lakshadweep below that, Maldives. But Lakshadweep, it has the 6 and 8 degrees north channel, which is the concentration of the sea lines of communication, especially for oil tankers and energy traffic, LPG and so on and so forth. So you got these things. You got, you don't look around for bases in Seychelles or in Maldives. Mauritius, we have got traditional historical relations which are very strong. That's there. We've been there for years and we have very good relations all around with Mauritius. With East Africa, we have reasonable relations. With South Africa, we've got good relations. With the Gulf of Aden, traditionally it's been the gateway to the east. It's a choke point where traffic concentrates after the Suez Canal, South Africa. And you've got the Persian Gulf, a friendly Persian Gulf, whether Iran or the Gulf states, or Iraq, etc., Syria, is a sine qua non of the concept of strategic frontiers, which is integral to both the foreign policy people, that the MEA, and to the defense establishment, and especially to the Navy. So this is not a new concept. We have to make these strategic frontiers, both in the west, south, east, more robust, more stable, closer to us, economic, trade, even military, if you want to call it, military interaction, normal interaction between the military, between the navies, which we have been doing. In fact, there was an Indian Ocean Literal States Conference in 2008 in Delhi, convened largely at the initiative of the Navy. So have we forgotten? Only 10 years you forget, or shall we say 6 years you forget what you have discussed, what you passed. That is the real strength of this country, its geographical position, its maritime tradition, its indigenous Navy building and design and building base, including a nuclear second strike component. These are the strengths. We don't have to look around. We are not a small country. We are not Australia. which is underpopulated. We are not, without Saudi Arabia. One of the great experts, regarded as great expert in India, K. Subramaniam, I'll name him, whose son was also Jay Shankar, the foreign secretary, said, the Saudis built a security relationship with the US, Pentagon, when they acquire and buy arms, billions of dollars, the second, third largest importer of arms in the world. And why should we not build it? He said it in writing, in a document which he submitted to the Vajpayee government of strategic path ahead, 2020. No, it didn't make sense. It's already not making sense. Because I think from the recent moves within the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, whether with its to Moscow and Sochi, frequent meetings with President Putin, and make up kind of relations with China post-Daklam, we seem to have realized, or we have a reappreciation or a review of the situation, that these things from faraway shores is not what is required to strengthen the security, not what is required to be a part of the maritime policy of India. Is not required to be the cannon fodder as we were in the 19th century. I told you about Shanghai, told you about so many countries, Laos, Middle East, thereafter, everywhere. It's a well-known story. But that we quietly bide our time, strengthen our science and technology base, strengthen our industrial base, strengthen our economic development, strengthen our people, nutrition, so on and so forth. The unity of India. The unity of India is necessarily the cornerstone or the foundation of Asian unity. Asia unity cannot be without Indian unity. Indian unity is fundamental. When you say unity, it doesn't mean the unity of the finance commission, state's finance commission. It means the unity of all the people. And I repeat, all the people of India who are Indians in every sense of the term for thousands of years, for hundreds of years, thousands of years. It doesn't matter whether they belong. That's what the constitution says, underlying that everyone is an equal citizen, with equal justice, with equal rights, with equal duties. So we have this question of the unity of India foremost to, as the foundation for any defense policy, as the foundation for any maritime policy. Though nominally you might say, sailors and navies and ships and submarines don't mix around with the people. They do more than one realizes. Across is the naval dockyard, 200-year-old. The British ships of U.S. Navy, British Navy, everyone. The greatest ships of the world were built here by the Wadia shipbuilders. So the people are united. The people are united. They form the military. They give the money for the defense budget. Defense budget and Navy, Army, Air Force, well, it doesn't fall from the sky. It doesn't fall from the heaven. It is not dependent on the patronage of this group or that group. It may have certain influence. But it comes from the will of the people to sustain their armed forces. It is their armed forces. It is not the armed forces of anybody else. I do want to touch upon a subject which is actually related to this questions that you asked, the ethos, the direction of the question that you asked. Because without this narrative, or what I say, will not be complete. See, a lot of lip service is paid to developing human resources as a capital resource in the country, and especially in the armed force. The amounts invested in training, the amounts invested in continuous training, and for the combat preparedness of the armed forces is absolutely essential, and a lot of it is. But lately we see, unfortunately, that people who had no background, no training, no experience, no qualifications, Of course, common sense is above everything. Don't need qualifications as such. Don't have to be a BAMA or an engineer. But have literally nothing in their background to suggest that either that they can interfere with the chain of command of the armed forces, or that they can give orders and instructions to the armed forces, Army, Navy, Air Force, without understanding the basic ethos, the basic factors influencing morale, and therefore the combat readiness. Because morale is to material is 3:1 as a bargaining factor. How do they come and start giving instruction, interfering? From whence has this whole idea of national security advisor? I am not naming anybody because there is no need for name. The whole concept, where did it come from? Okay, the US president has a chief of staff, he has a national security council, he has a national security advisor. They have their own democracy, we have our own democracy. Here, parliament is in control. The cabinet form of government is responsible to the parliament and its select committees for the ultimate accountability in our form of government. The national security advisor is neither sanctioned by the constitution nor by the parliament. It has really no place. It has an advisory role. Of course, it has a secretariat and a council. Sometimes very capable people are there. But the point is that the national security advisor, as an institution, I'm saying, as a sub-institution of the PMO, cannot exercise command or suggestions of command or dealings of things which are connected to the chain of command of the Army, Navy, Air Force. So there is a basic problem that we are creating for ourselves, or we have created in the last 20 years now, 20 years since the Vajpayee government had a national security advisor. There's no need for me to comment on the national security advisor. I'm talking in terms of the relationships in the defense community. The second is that I do want to recall 1971 and the Bangladesh operations, because there have been invidious comments to say that the surgical strike carried out a few months ago is something comparable to Bangladesh. Nothing compared to Bangladesh. It was, if I may suggest, a peaking of the professional capabilities of the Indian Armed Force. The peaking, an excellent example of civil-military relations. Excellent, more than that, more than all these things, it is an outstanding world example of a war of movement, a war of independent strategic thought. I have tried to suggest that we have gone into a dependency syndrome, because if you allow others, no matter near or far, to influence, to control, to advise on your strategic thinking of what is possible, what should be done, what should not be done by this country, and then start depending on individual systems, which are really not strategic systems, also pay billions of dollars for them, billions of dollars, and think that you are somehow strengthening yourself. It doesn't make sense to a person like me. Doesn't make sense to a lot of people, because the moment you allow others to think for you, it's gone, it's over. But there is a psychology of dependence, a psyche of dependence, an atmosphere of dependence, an environment of dependency, starting foremost from the capital of India, New Delhi. I'll say this some regret and some knowledge. So first of all, foremost above everything, if you're talking about maritime policy, yes, Indian maritime policy, not suggested maritime policy, not because you've given up, you're not thinking, you're not like, even, I mean, all the senior military commanders are, in my view, somewhat to introspect. The requirement is to introspect and now say, where do we go? Do we stop here? No more. Whatever we may have said and done is over. Now we need to recollect. Connect to the Indian people. Connect to the basic political economy of this country. Basic legitimate aspirations of self-reliance and defense of this vast subcontinent and vast India. Relative to others, they have no business to, nobody has a business to intervene or interfere or aggress or do Doklam or any other thing which you wish to remember. The Kashmir, nobody, no foreign interests have any place in Kashmir. Kashmir is our business. Kashmiris are our people. Kashmiris are our brothers and sisters. And this question of Article 370 autonomy is completely bogus. It doesn't really like it. Even the United States have got states. They have the freedom of secession. They have their own. They have their own law. They have their own Supreme Court. So did the Soviet Union. So does Russia. So does China have autonomous region. Every large country has to have a. And we have it in India. We have it in Tamil Nadu and Tamil Nadu problems came at us. We have it in Nagaland. We have it in the Northeast. We have it everywhere. So why are we sending out Kashmir to a dangerously, to a dangerous point? It's not related to maritime policy, and yet it is. Because are you saying that you are defending the oceans and the seas and the exclusive economic zone? And that is, Kashmir is somehow separate? No, Kashmir is an integral part of India. What happens is Kashmir is there. As a famous person who I respect said recently, if we can't save or be safe, if we can't ensure safety in Kashmir, then how do we ensure safety in India? It's not a philosophical question. It's a political issue. And we can't. And we cannot, because the whole of India, Kashmir secularism was predicated on the India being a secular country. I may have gone beyond your question, but they need to be recorded. Because, I mean, there is no such thing in maritime. The admirals can't say that we determine in maritime policy. The foreign service can't say we determine policy. No, we have gone through what determines a country's maritime policy. It's geopolitical position, its peninsular character, all the factors that go in, the resources from the sea, its trade, foreign trade, its economic strengths and weaknesses, they determine. The Navy is one instrument of state policy. Let me be very clear, if somebody tries to say that there is an a priori right of some admiral or the other, or some people in South Bloc, to determine maritime policy, they are mistaken. The least I can, the most polite thing I can say is that they are genuinely mistaken and they need to rethink. So, in conclusion, I would just like to say one thing, that we may just be at the Plassey moment, 1757. We just passed 2017. Are we at the Plassey moment? Is the interplay of forces, both internal and external, driving us to a Plassey moment, a dangerous moment? A dangerous moment is a central point of our discussion, of our interaction this morning, is sovereignty. Sovereignty. That is the national question. Nationalism is part. You don't chase nationalism. I'm a nationalist, I fly the flag, I do this, I do that. Sovereignty, political sovereignty in decision making, economic sovereignty so far as the allocation of resources and utilization of resources, the manner in which we develop, is it some privatized economy? Is it an economy of inequality, of extreme inequality like the United States, India, sorry, where 0.1% or 1% of the people have all the resources, 80% of the resources, and 80%, 90% of the people have nothing to look forward to, whether in education, health, housing, anything. All the wealth is concentrated and becoming more and more concentrated. Then what would you defend? What is the military supposed to defend? Is the military supposed to defend the 0.1%? Is it supposed to defend the 1%? It defends the whole of India. Whole of India, natural, not natural borders and natural frontiers, whether at sea or oceans, or whether on land, or whether in the air. Or is it a matter which is a vital key concern to all the people of India? Thank you so much.